What's interesting is Gates isn't even on the oversight committee, so it's just like he's trying to get in on the game and sort of, you know, please Daddy Trump. I mean, that's essentially, you know, he's just trying to get himself in the headlines and let the president know, you know, he's willing to be, you know, thuggish or threatening or whatever, however you want to call it.
That's right. And, you know, we have to ask ourselves whether we are doing his bidding by, you know, putting this slur out there in public. Frankly, as a member of Congress, I think, you know, this is news and it is worth talking about.
Yeah, I mean, this isn't
about
some guy who's just, you know, he is a sitting member of Congress.
Right.
It's just like, where, what, didn't there used to be some dignity? Like, is somewhere on Capitol Hill?
A long time ago.
Have you been paying attention?
Yeah, I know, but I mean, I'm still naive in that way.
Where have you been? I mean, no, I mean, this is like, you know, it's the way Trump, the president talks about people who cooperate.
No, I know.
As opposed,
I mean,
it's
like
all
this
mob
guy
talk.
Gates saying, like, is your wife going to be faithful while you're in prison? I mean,
it's
how
mob
low
talk.
Rent is this guy?
Gates is threatening to, like, crash the committee. He wants to go there. He's trying to get permission because he's not on the committee. Yeah. And he wants to ask his serious question maybe about Michael Cohen's alleged extramarital affairs, which, of course, have an awful lot to do with the subject matter at hand.
The world is waiting to hear about who Michael Cohen has been having sex
exactly
with.
I have to say, though, Anderson, my favorite line from Gates today was, this is what it looks like to compete in the marketplace of ideas.
Mm. Oh, yeah, that's what this
what
is.
What idea is this? Yeah. What idea?
But you know, I don't think we can underestimate just what a big deal this is tomorrow. Because, you know, 50 years from now, this is going to be these pictures of Cohn talking about what went on. You know, just as we remember Watergate through the lens of John Dean's testimony, we remember Iran-Contra through the lens of Oliver North's testimony. This is how American scandals get remembered. And we haven't had anyone talk this way yet. And, you know, I don't know where it's going to go. You know, I doubt many minds will be changed. But this will be a defining moment in the Trump presidency, for
you
better
know,
or for worse.
And this is absolutely a Shakespearean story. I mean, you have somebody who was his greatest defender, I'd take a bullet for Donald Trump, who flips on him and now is determined, as he says, not to be the villain in this story, but to tell the truth, facing his jail time. So as you were pointing out earlier, Anderson, it's Michael Cohen's credibility, which we all understand has been shredded. He's admitted to lying to Congress and he's going to go to jail for it, versus Donald Trump's.
Yeah.
Who
I'm not
hasn't
sure it rises
lying
to the level of a Shakespeare, maybe like a pulp novel, but
there
like,
you go.
Not quite sure.
Well,
I'm
but
with
the,
that.
Yeah. The betrayal, let's put it that way. The way that Trump
feels about
Cohen.
Not two houses divided, you know.
All right. Maybe I'll give you a pulp novel.
All right, Gloria Borger, thank you. Jeff Toobin as well.